Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to this service of Holy Communion. Welcome to all of you that I know and those that I don't know, but I'm hoping to get to know. You all have your notice sheets, I take it. Please do take them home and read them. We do have this habit of not doing that, and then we forget things and we miss things, so please do that. Other than that, I think we'll get on with our service, and we'll begin by singing our first hymn, number of 354. I'm not sure what it's called, but we'll find out when the music starts. Jesus. The second is this: love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And so, shall we stand and say the Gloria together? Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
Let us pray. God, our light and our salvation, illuminate our lives that we may see your goodness in the land of the living, and looking on your beauty, may be changed into the likeness of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for our readings.
A reading from Hebrews chapter 5. Every high priest chosen from among mortals is put in charge of things pertaining to God on their behalf, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is subject to weakness. And because of this, he must offer sacrifice for his own sins, as well as for those of the people. And one does not presume to take this honour, but takes it only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you," as he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And so we stand to sing hymn number 60, "Be Still for the Presence of the Lord."
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to him and said to him, Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you. And he said to them, What is it that you want me to do for you? And they said to him, Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left, in your glory. But Jesus said to them, You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? They replied, We are able. Then Jesus said to them, The cup that I drink, you will drink, and with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared. When the ten heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
May I speak in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Well, I'll be a kipper in a tree. I often say that when I'm surprised and shocked. I'm not sure what the disciples might have said, but I don't think they were impressed with James and John. In many respects, this was all of the disciples showing their humanity, warts and all. Amazingly, it was on the back of all these disciples that Jesus chose to build his church, which in many respects also gives us a heart of encouragement for when we get things wrong, because God doesn't give up on us. But can you imagine how our application for discipleship might have been viewed, and that of the disciples chosen by Jesus? Especially if our suitability for discipleship had been sent to an agency to check on that suitability. Might it go something like this? Dear sir, thank you for submitting the profiles of the men you have chosen for managerial positions. We have evaluated them according to the norms required and find that the candidates are lacking in background, education, and aptitude for the type of enterprise that you are undertaking. Whoops, I had no idea I had applied, but obviously I have. They don't seem to have any concept of teamwork, and we suggest you continue your search. Simon, who you refer to as Peter, is emotionally unstable. I'm given to fits of temper. He is not the sort of person in a crisis to keep a cool head. His brother Andrew, as indeed Philip too, seem to be followers and seem to have no leadership skills at all. James and John Zebedee, no, they don't bounce, place personal interests above loyalty. Furthermore, they seem to have a temperamental flaw. I believe you describe them as the sons of thunder. This puts a question mark on how they might react under pressure. Thomas demonstrates an unhealthy questioning attitude. We also feel it is our duty to inform you that Matthew has been blacklisted by the Jerusalem Chamber of Commerce. James and Simon, also known as Thaddeus, have radical leanings. And we wonder if Nathaniel's heart is really in it. A bit like Thomas' questioning attitude. In conclusion, there is only one candidate who shows potential. He has contacts in high places and is highly motivated, ambitious and responsible. And so we recommend that you appoint Judas Iscariot as your right-hand man. Yours sincerely, J. Barabbas. Oh boy, it seems that indeed Jesus really does buck the trend. It seems that suitability counts a little in God's thinking. For God's ways are not our ways. In everything, God has a purpose. Surely God knew their characters, but sometimes those characters just have to play out in man's ways as well. In man's ways, we are often encouraged to strive for positions of power and prestige. Well, that was nothing new in Jesus' age, and it's nothing new today. Let's face it, it's a jungle out there. For it seems that this is what James and John were after. And of course, we see the reaction of the other 10 disciples. For to sit on the right and on the left of Christ was asking to be the power behind the throne in God's kingdom. They wanted to get the top spots for themselves. But we know, don't we, that this is not God's way. It's not how he works. For God is looking for servant leaders. Look at what Jesus said. Whoever wants to become great amongst you, you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first must be a slave to all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. So what does this tell us? It tells us that service is at the head of our Christian faith. And that service might well come at a cost. For Jesus asked James and John, can you drink the cup I drink? Or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with? They answered, we can. Jesus replied, to sit at my right or my left is not for me to grant. In servanthood, and as a ransom for you and I, Jesus was prepared to die. Jesus was prepared to give his life for us. Jesus, the servant king, our servant king, which kind of sounds like an oxymoron, you know, servant stroke king. Surely a king doesn't serve, does he? It appears that the challenge for us today as Christians is that we are called to serve and not seek positions of influence and power. But the problem is, we still have that human need for that position and power. In light of this, let us listen again to what Jesus is saying to us. Whoever wants to become great amongst you must be servants. And whoever wants to be first must be a slave to all. For there is a great difference between secular power and God's power. In many ways, Paul sums it up perfectly. Your attitude should be the same as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and came obedient to death, even death on the cross. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name above all names, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And so, my friends, let this be our food for thought. Let this be something to take with us all today. Amen.
Amen.
So shall we stand and together declare our faith in God. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated for our intercession.
Lord God, we pray for your church and for the world. We pray for our church leaders, our archbishops and bishops, our clergy and readers, our church wardens, and all those who serve you in this benefice and throughout the world. We pray that you will assist them in their ministries and duties and guide them by your Spirit. Lord, in your mercy,
hear.
We pray for our nation. We pray especially for the Southend MP whose life was cruelly taken. We thank you that he had a strong faith, that he was a man who followed you and is now with you. Lord, we pray for his family in their sorrow, and pray that they will know your comfort. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, we bring before you the world you created, and in which humanity seems compelled at times to destroy. We pray especially for the COP summit and the world leaders, and that they will come together in agreement of a way forward, just as Her Majesty the Queen commented, not just talk about it. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, we remember those who suffer from illness and pain, and ask your healing and comfort upon them. And we remember those who have died, and the sadness of the families who loved and missed them. Help us as your servants to care for them in compassion and love. We pray especially for those known only to ourselves and those who have asked for our prayers. We pray for Reverend Stephen and Ruth Pratt, John Jordan, June Cooper, and the families and friends of Alina Chapman and James Eisen. Heavenly Father, hold them in your loving care. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen. Amen.
Heavenly Father, help us to be the disciples you would wish us to be. Not for just this day or tomorrow, but for each day as we journey with you. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
And so we come to a time of peace. God is love, and those who live in love live in God, and God lives in them. The peace of the Lord be also always with you.
And also with you.
You can share that peace in any way you feel that is suitable. You can wave, clap, blow kisses, or give your neighbour a hug. And now we sing hymn number 445. Meekness and majesty. Good choice.
Perfect harmony.
Most merciful Lord, your love compels us to come in. God of our salvation, and share your bread with sinners. So cleanse and feed us with the precious body and blood of your Son, that he may live in us and we in him, and that we with the whole company of Christ may sit and eat in your kingdom. Amen.
Thank you.
we say together at the bottom of page 30, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. To him we offer you our souls and bodies, to be a new sacrifice. Send us out to the power of your Spirit, to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. And now we sing our final hymn.
My soul, my Savior, Lord, to thee.
hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
My dearest of friends, go in peace to love and to serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Amen. Amen.
Right, all of them.